Good evening,
Good evening.
everybody. It's my pleasure to welcome you today in our webinar titled Organizational Change. I'm your host today. My name is Mohammed Arweli, and I'm a training and development volunteer at BMI KSA chapter. I would also like to welcome our speaker today, Mr. Harsh Johari, who has about 27 years of diverse professional experience across shipping, financial services, and people development. He is also passionate about training and coaching leaders and helping them achieve their dreams and reach their true potential. This is an educational program designed for PMI KSA chapter. So, Mr. Harsh, you may start.
Thank you so much for inviting me. It's a privilege to be part of today's discussion. And thank you all for joining in today's program on change management. Let me quickly share my screen. So today's topic is organizational change management, and in specifically, how do you as business leaders drive change within your organization? Now, before I begin, I know all of you sort of have been through the working day, but I just want to make sure, just to make sure we get most of it. We will try to keep this session as interactive as possible. Whenever I ask questions, please engage in either verbal discussions or chats. There's no right or wrong answer here. Everything is welcome. The more we share, the more we can learn from each other. So those are some just basic ground rules. I just want to quickly check for all those who have joined us, what is your energy level as of today? Like, are you excited about this? Are you tired? Is a lot going in your life? Can you type your response in the chat box? I, on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 means my energy level is low, 10 means my energy level is very high for attending this webinar. What is your energy level today? If you can type in the chat box between on scale of 1 to 10, so we know whether people are really engaged, they are really looking forward to the discussion. So some lights at 5, Noora says 4, Ahmed says 10, is excited. Okay, 8, excellent. Ahmed says 7, 10, Salim says 10. So yeah, I mean, different energy levels. I know it's the end of the day. All of you have been through the full day, but I see a lot of people are saying 7, 8, 9, 10. So this is great. Everybody is. A lot of you are quite focused and excited. So thanks a lot for showing up. And the second question I have for all of you is, how would you rate your focus today, right now, as you are busy coming to this webinar? Do you think you are extremely focused, or do you think you're distracted? Again, on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 means I have too much going on, 10 means I'm very focused right now to learn. 7. Okay, I see 7, 7, Noora says 7. Mohammed Khalid, all of 7, 7, 10. So most of you are ranging between 6 to 8, 9, 10 in terms of energy and focus, which is great. As I said, I know it's end of day, so I know a lot is going on. You are looking forward to the evening, but you're here for a reason, and my job is to make sure that you get most of the today's session. Thank you so much for sharing your opinion. So why are we here today? We are going to learn about how to lead and drive change in an organization. And a lot of you could be in the role of project managers, program managers. And before we begin, I want to draw a distinction between project management and change management. Now, the key difference in this is typically project management looks at the process side of it, whereas change management looks at the people side of it. So for example, let's say you're having a technology change, a new software is getting implemented in your organization. There will be a project management team who will look into the implementation, you know, which software, which vendors, what are the timelines, UAT testing, go live, all that will be managed through a project management process. But when you're changing a software, there will be impact to people also, right? A lot of people will need to be retrained. A lot of people will have to learn new about the software. A lot of people who are old timers in the organizations could show a lot of resistance to change. So that is where the change management comes into the picture in terms of dealing with the people side of change. And a lot of organizations are very good in project management, in program management, but sometimes ignore the people side of it. And that is why it is important to know about change management and how to manage people through any form of change. Now, why is change management so important as of today, in today's context? Why is it important? We have seen that in the last 12 to 18 months, the way we interact, the way we communicate, the way we conduct business has completely changed. The world has completely changed and will continue to evolve, right? Continue to change. So the only way for us as business leaders, as businesses itself, to survive and grow is through the process of change. And if you really look at what has happened over the last 12 to 18 months and what future holds for us, what you realize is earlier we used to believe that it is the survival of the fittest. But we have seen that it is no more about survival of the fittest. Now the new world order is about survival of the fastest. Who can change, who can adapt fastest? It's about agility, about nimbleness. And that is why change is important. That's one factor. And you will see a lot of business models have evolved over the last 12 to 18 months. You will find a lot of businesses which could not change, have not really grown that much. The second fact is that the pace at which change is happening around us, the velocity of change is much, much faster than how we can embrace and react. So whether you are working today, whether you are running your business, whether you're a business owner, professional, all of us will get impacted by all the change happening around us sooner or later. So you're not insulated. So you need to be ready to lead change, drive change in your organizations. And the third thing is more at both at a personal level and also a business level is whatever has got you here up to this point of time will not take you further. So that's just the nature of growth, right? Whatever has brought you here in terms of skills or business models will need to evolve for you to create more impact in the new world order. So that is why, again, change is needed at an individual leader level, at a business level. And that's why this is the time when to think about change, to think about agility, to think about how do I deal with uncertainty. So today we are going to discuss change using a very popular model. This model is called the ADKAR model, ADKAR. This model was developed a long time back by Proshi, and it's a model which is used worldwide across organizations when they are looking to manage change. And as we will go through this model, you will also know that if one of the stages of this model does not work, why change initiatives in organizations fail. So we'll go through each of this phase of the model step by step. And then we'll take the question answers towards end of the webinar. So the first A stands for awareness, and I'll go into more details. D stands for desire. K stands for knowledge. A stands for ability, and R stands for reinforcement. So these are the five key pillars of change management using the ADKAR model. Now, very important to remember about the ADKAR model, it is sequential. A, D, K, A, R. It has to follow that sequence. You know, it has to be followed step by step. You cannot jump a step. For example, you cannot go from awareness to knowledge. You have to go from awareness to desire. So you cannot jump any step. You have to follow each phase in a sequential manner. That is a key. Whenever an organization or a leader tries to skip the ADKAR model one phase, that is where the change management fails. For example, if you don't look at desire and straight away jump from awareness to knowledge, something will not work when you're implementing change. Similarly, if you skip the awareness part and straight away jump into desire and knowledge, the change will not be successful in the long run. So this is a very, very fundamental thing to understand about ADKAR model is it is sequential, it is step by step, and we cannot jump any step. So if you keep that in mind, we'll now do a quick deep dive into what is ADKAR and what do you need to know in each of these phases. A is for awareness. Awareness, why is that change needed? Now, a lot of organizations, what they do is whenever the change is happening, the senior most leadership team decide there is a change, and then the messaging happens very top down. So a lot of times teams are not even aware that what was the business reason why this change is happening. So they are caught off guard, and typically people show a lot of resistance because they were not aware why is this really needed, right? So this awareness question is not that a change is happening, but more why it is needed. That's the awareness part. In a lot of organizations, what happens, people have decided change is happening, they send emails, they send newsletters, and that is the first time you will hear about the change. That is not the right way. The right way is to make people aware that why is the change needed for the teams or the function or the business. That is the first phase of the ADKAR model, is creating awareness of why the change is needed. So you need to focus on different steps, but the key question into answer is about why. Why do we need to change, or why does the process need to change, or why are we implementing this new software? People need to understand that. Otherwise, what you'll see is a lot of people will start showing resistance if they don't get the business reason. And as business leaders, when you are going back to your organizations, when you're looking at the awareness piece, what you need to think about is three questions. First is, what will happen if we change? which means that if the change is implemented, what are the benefits of that change? If you're changing a software, if you're changing a team structure, if you're changing a vendor, what is the benefit we will gain because of that change? So that's the first thing. What are the possibilities which can get created? So one is the immediate benefits. The other is also long-term benefits. What sort of possibilities can be created if you create that change? And the third and most important thing in terms of awareness is what will happen if we don't change? Now, this is the key, right? This is known as cost of inaction. If you don't change, what will happen? A lot of time organizations are focusing on the return on investment or the ROI of change, how the benefits will be there, but they don't pay enough focus on what will happen if we don't change. For example, let's say it's a question of changing the putting a new software in your organization, and let's say the software license is expiring or the software is getting upgraded or the software company got acquired and cannot provide services in the future, then you need to change, because if you don't change, at some point you will not get the support and the service because of the change in terms and conditions. So there is a need to change. So when you are trying to create awareness about change, you need to focus on both the benefits of change in the immediate term, the benefits of the change in the longer term, and what will happen if we don't change. This is very, very important, because if you don't show people this entire picture, some of people or some of the team members will not get why this change is happening, why it is needed. They will say, you know, everything is going fine, why should I change? Because change by definition creates discomfort. It creates a lot of anxiety. It creates a lot of worries. It creates a lot of fear in people, you know, because it unsettles people. People don't want to be unsettled. We all want to remain comfortable. And change in any form will create that discomfort. So people will make every possible way to avoid that discomfort. And your job as managers, as business leaders, is to make sure you're creating that level of awareness so that while there is still discomfort, but people get it. People understand that, yes, this change is needed. So that's the first phase of Adgar, is around awareness. And what you want is, how can you create awareness, right? So when you know, okay, I need to create awareness, how can you create that awareness? And the various ways is you can create a proper communication plan in your organization. Communication, not at the last one, but communication planning has to happen much in advance. And the type of questions we need to think about is this, whose audience, when I'm trying to communicate about change, to whom will I communicate? That's the first question you should go back and think. Second, what will be the message? What will be the medium? No, is it emails? Is it town halls? Is it one-to-one meetings? Is it group meetings? Is it training sessions? How will I communicate about change? Different organizations will and ideally should use different medium available, because people consume information from different sources today, right? So who's the audience? What will be the message? And what will be the medium? And then when will you communicate? Timing? Will you communicate at the last moment? Will you communicate? How early can you start communicating so that people start getting used to that change, or at least start getting the understanding of change, start raising their questions or queries so that you can address them well in advance? And who will the messenger, you know, is it the CNMOS leadership team? Is it team managers? Will you appoint change advocates? In some organizations, they have change champions. So who will actually be conveying message? So if you look at this, awareness creation becomes a whole action plan, and you need to create a very careful strategy around change management using these points. Who's the audience, who's the messenger, frequency, content, and the mode. So if you take these five questions, and if you are currently managing a change today, you can actually go back and create an action plan for your teams if you're currently leading some change. Now, there are various modes of communication available. Again, you have to make sure that you use all available means and modes of communication so that you have the maximum reach and the maximum impact. And typically what will happen in most organizations, you'll have town halls. A lot of senior leaders go and give this town hall where they address a large set of audience. You can generate emails and newsletters. You can have team meetings. In some cases, you may need to have one-to-one meetings, especially with senior members. Members who are feeling very discomfortable, who have a lot of questions, there may be need to have even one-to-one meetings. You can do a lot of knowledge sharing sessions, especially if it is something new to the organization, people are not aware of it. There could be a lot of knowledge session and training sessions can be organized. In a lot of organizations, you have intranet bulletin boards. You have in intranet where you can post. You can prepare speaking points for managers, for leaders to address in their individual team meetings. And you can also create information packs. You know, you can create a one pager or a set of slides which you can circulate quickly around, like an FAQ type of document. You can create posters. So you'll see there's a whole lot of modes of communication you can use to communicate about the awareness of change. And as I said, different people will consume information from different sources. So I will strongly recommend that if you are currently leading a change or in future you're going to lead and drive change, make sure you use all available means to drive change. The one point is very, very important, which is not mentioned, is the feedback mechanism. Now, this is very important because when you are communicating to the teams about change, you will also get some feedback as to whether people are happy about it, what are the concerns, why people are worried, what questions people have. And you need to make sure you provide people the safe space, you provide them the right platform to voice their concerns, to give feedback to you. The change itself may not, you may not go away from the change, change will still happen, but you need to make sure people get that platform to voice out their opinion. A lot of times, while people are resisting change, they will go through the change, but they want to be heard. So make sure that you provide them the right platform to give feedback all through the process, not just during change, but prior to change, during change, and after the change. That will create a lot of trust. People feel heard, and you will also get a lot of feedback as to what is working, what is not working. So this feedback mechanism is very, very important. And as business leaders, you need to keep an open mind, saying, I'm going to be receptive to the feedback without any judgment. I'm going to give people time and space, and I'm going to take notice of it. If people are telling me something, if the pulse on the ground is something, I need to hear it. So that's really how you communicate about awareness of change. So that covers the awareness part, why the change is needed, what are the benefits, what are the long-term benefits, and also what will happen if you don't change. This becomes a part of the communication strategy and using different modes of communication. So that's the first phase of Edgar. Ultimately, when you are creating this awareness, when you are communicating, what do you want from people? You want people to say, I get it. If your awareness phase is run successfully and powerfully, then people should say, yes, I get it. I understand why the change is needed and I'm with you. So that's what you want. The final outcome is people should tell you this message. If people are still saying, I don't get it, I don't know why it is required, why it should be changed, then somewhere something needs to be done in that awareness or the communication planning. So that's the first stage of Edgar. The second stage is of desire. Desire means, you want to make sure people participate in that change, they engage in that change from their own side. It should not be forced upon them. They should participate willingly. Now, it's easier said than done. People will not willingly participate because, as I said, by default, we don't want to change. Whether it's professional life, personal life, we want to remain comfortable. We want to remain in a fixed setting. Change brings in worry. Change brings in anxiety. So we don't want. So why should anybody participate in change? That is what is addressed in this phase called D for desire. And what you need to understand is everybody, every single person, no matter who they are, where they are in the organization hierarchy, everybody cares only for this. What's in it for me? If some change is happening, how will I benefit? That's the only thing people care about, messaging. And you need to make sure you address this point very, very carefully, because if I don't understand why the change is important for me, then I will not participate actively. I may still participate, but it will not be an active participation willingly. So you need to make sure you address this point, what's in it for me, for all the team members. Now, and how is the change impacting? How will they benefit in the long run from that change? So that's the key part of the phase of desire. Now, the interesting part about desire is, look, desire is very personal. Each of you, all those who are joining us today and all your team members, you have individual desires, right? You have your own dreams. You have your own desires. You have your own fears. You have your own frustrations. You have your own goals, your own ambitions. It's a very, very personal thing. It cannot, there is nothing which you can apply at a team level, because all of us get motivated from different things, right? It could be from personal situations, ambitions, experiences, you know, all this, what we value most, what we like, what we dislike, all these go into what is my personal situation? What motivates me? What you like, I may not like. What motivates you may not motivate me. What is my ambition may not be your ambition. So that's why the desire piece is very, very personal. And that's why there is a need to have some level of personal attention to people as much as possible to understand what motivates people. Right? Obviously, there's a limitation in terms of time and scale, but the more you can get to that level, the better it is, because it's very personal. Now, remember this thing, you cannot control people's desire. You cannot control people's desire, but you can influence it. Now, what do I mean by that? If I like something, you cannot make me dislike it, right? But you can influence my liking through various actions. Like a simple example, what happens at home, sometimes for those, all of you have kids, right? Sometimes kids don't like certain type of food. Let's say they don't like vegetables, you know, common example, if kids don't like some vegetables. Now you cannot force them to like the vegetables. All you can do is you can cook the vegetables and give it a taste which people, kids like, and sometimes kids will eat that. So if the vegetable is cooked to their taste, sometimes a lot of kids may end up eating it. So you can only influence it. You cannot force them to like vegetables. It's a very simple example, but that's the whole point. You cannot control people's desire, you can only influence. Now, question is, how do I influence? That's what you need to understand. And that's why this model is so powerful. You need to understand fundamentally that people don't change. People don't take action until and unless the pain is high or the gain is high. You have to understand this very, very fundamental level. And this is true for all of us here. We don't change. We don't take any action until and unless we feel that the pain is high. Pain is high means whatever my current situation is, now it is becoming unbearable, and hence I need to change. Or we see a strong gain from that situation. Only then we'll change. Otherwise, we'll maintain status quo. That's the default position for everybody. And if you get this for yourself, every person in your team and people around you will also be going through the same situation. They will not change till the pain is high or the gain is high. So for some people, the pain is a motivator that I want to avoid pain. For some people, gain is a motivator that I want to gain something by changing. So you need to understand, okay, what motivates people? Now, how can you influence that desire? How can you look into this? There are various ways. One is sponsorship and role modeling. For example, as a business leader, if I want certain behavior to be displayed, I'm going to role model that behavior. Now, for example, simple thing. If I want my team members to come on time, I'm going to come on time. So when my team members see me coming on time regularly, they see that this is how my leaders are behaving, so I should also come on time. Again, going back to situation at home, you know, role modeling is a very good example from a parent's point of view. For all those who have kids, kids watch parents and they role model the behavior. Same thing happens at an organization level. Your team members will observe your behavior, observe your habits, and they will role model it subconsciously. So if you want to influence certain behavior, you need to make sure you display that behavior so that you become a role model, you become a champion and sponsor, and people follow that. Not everybody will get influenced, but a large part could get influenced who look up to you. Like, for example, if you want to maintain work-life balance and if you leave on time, then people will say, yes, this is a leader who believes in work-life balance. He or she comes on time, leaves on time. So we should also model that behavior. So that is one way to influence. The second is influence, which could be a very big reason, is immediate managers. In a lot of organizations, because of the matrix and the hierarchy, sometimes you may not have access to the senior most leaders. So who influences your behavior most? Your immediate manager, to whom you report. So how is the immediate manager behaving? What sort of interaction he or she is having with you? What is the messaging they are conveying to you? That can influence a lot in terms of how you react to that change. So immediate managers play a very, very important role. So if you are an immediate manager and you're part of the change, please understand that you play a very, very important role in change management. One-to-one conversation, obviously, can be very, very helpful. Again, not scalable, but if there are certain key people in your organization, key people who are decision makers, whom you want to sort of participate actively in the change, then one-to-one conversation definitely helps. As I said, giving people the platform to voice concern is also a way to influence them, because people feel heard. And a lot of times people just want to say things and that's about it. They are okay to participate in the change, but they want to be heard. So giving that platform can also help influence the active participation in the change. And in some cases, you know, you could give incentives and benefits. It may not necessarily be monetary benefits. It could be new projects. It could be other former stretch assignments. Sometimes it's a big change, it could be bonuses, could be a variety of incentives which can influence people to participate in that change. So this is very important to understand that desire is personal, and as the business leaders, you need to make sure you influence that desire so that people actively participate in that change. Now, once you complete this phase, which is D is for desire, what do you want from people? Ultimately, what you want is people should say, I will participate in this change. I get it and I will participate. So that's the outcome you're looking for from a desire point of view. The third phase, which is the K, which is knowledge. So far we said, why we need to change and why individuals should participate in change. Now we're going to say, okay, how to change? Now I know what to change, why to change. Now, what should I do? How should I go about it? So K is for knowledge. So K is knowledge. It means what are the behaviors? What are the skills you want people to develop so that the change can happen, right? That's what are the new processes you want people to learn? What are the new tools you want people to learn? What are the new systems or processes you need to develop for the change to happen? So now we get into the execution mode, the how part. What are the roles and responsibilities during the change and after the change? So all this now, if you look at this, it talks about execution. It talks about how to take steps to make the change happen. So these are three things: behavior and skills, processes, systems, roles and responsibilities during the change and after the change. Now remember, what can you do in terms of managing this part, which is a knowledge part? A lot is through trainings, because especially if it is something new, let's say a new software is getting implemented in your organization, people may not be aware of that software, right? So you need to train people how to use that software. So training becomes a big part of the knowledge component in terms of what are the new behaviors, what skills people need to develop, and what new processes they can need to get trained on. So training is a huge component. Now, training does not mean you have to do the training. It could be other change management champions in the organization. It could be your learning and development team. It could be your training teams. So it could be a combination of people who get involved into the training or knowledge imparting part. So, but what you need to understand is what is the current knowledge level? How much people know about it? Sometimes there are people who know something about the news change. Sometimes people are not knowing. So what is the gap currently? For example, let's say if it's just an upgrade of a software which people are used to the old software, people may be familiar with it. But sometimes it's completely new vendor, a brand new software implementing, people may not have worked. So what is the current understanding of people and what is the gap? That can determine what sort of training people need, right? What is the audience ability to learn? Again, ability to learn means some people will learn fast, some people will learn slow, some people will learn with personal training, some people can learn from videos. So how do people engage in learning is important to understand when you're looking at the training curriculum. What is the medium to use, right? It should be open office hours, like for everybody, should be in small group settings. As I said, it could be video demos being done. What is the right medium and resources to use to impart this training and knowledge? What is the timing and frequency? How often should we do it? Is it just a one-time thing? Has it to be done regularly? Need to happen during the change, even after that change? So all this will go into your training plan. And in some cases, there could be people who need even one-to-one support, right? Some people may have a huge resistance to that change. Some people may not be so conversant with let's say technology aspect, right? And some people could be very senior people who need some more hand-holding. So all these questions, if you look at it, can help you create a very robust training plan to look at the knowledge component of the change. And if you are able to implement this successfully, ultimately what will happen is If you're able to impart the training, if you're able to explain people what behaviors are expected, what skills you expect them to do, what are the roles and responsibilities during and after change, what are the processes they need to develop or get trained on, ultimately what you're expecting people to do is they should tell you, I know how to do it. Right? Earlier, I get it, why I should change, I will participate in the change, and now I know how to do it. That is the whole objective of the K or the knowledge phase. Without that, change will not happen. The change will not be successful. The fourth phase of the Edgar is about ability. Now, ability means, okay, I know how to do it, but I've not done it. Now I have to put it into action. I've seen a video, I've attended a training program, but I've actually not done it. Now I need to go and get my hands dirty and do that action or apply whatever I've learned into practice. That is what the ability. And this is not just true for change, this is true for any training you're going through. If you are going through a training, whatever learning you get out of the training, if you're not going to apply and practice, that learning will be lost over time. You'll forget it. But yes, if you even pick up one or two things and go back and apply, then you'll find over a period of time, you can practice and become good at it. So A is about ability. Now, key thing to remember is there's a difference between how to do and I'm actually able to do that. I can attend every training program, but still not be able to do that because the gap is in the action part. So there's a difference between how to do and able to do. So that's able to do is where ability comes in picture. How to do means what are the new behaviors? Now you're saying, okay, I want people to start doing stuff so that they actually develop those behaviors and they actually display and demonstrate those skills. They actually implement the new systems and processes. So now it is about actually doing things on the ground. Now remember, knowledge is not ability. Like for example, we are having this webinar, you can learn a lot about change management through this webinar, but if you don't go and practice, if you don't go and apply, you may not necessarily be able to lead and drive change. So the proof of the pudding will lie when you go and apply a change on the ground, right? So knowledge is not ability, right? Ability leads to action, leads to results. That's the concept you have to understand. So if I've learned something, I need to go and apply, I need to act on it, I need to practice it, I need to learn from mistakes. Only then will I start seeing results over a period of time. So ability, action, result, that's the journey. Don't just stop at knowledge. Make sure people, whatever they're learning, they're applying. It could be you who's going through a change. It could be your team members who's going through a change. Make sure people are taking action on the ground so that they get the results. Now, how do you do that? How do you actually ensure that people develop those skills or develop those behaviors? Now, you need to devote time and you need to report resources and a support system so that people get a chance to practice. Like you can learn a lot in theory, but if you don't give people a chance to practice and try it out, then people will not develop those abilities and skills. So this is where you need to make sure you are planning the change in such a way that you are giving people time and resources and the right set of support system to practice and learn. Again, what do you do it? A lot of them, you can do a lot of hand-holding, one-to-one coaching. You can provide them safe environment. What do you mean a safe environment? Sometimes there is simulation trainings happening. Sometimes you're doing training. You've not gone live, but you're training in the test environment. So various ways for people to practice things without creating any risk into the system so that people get their hand. Just like when you go for a driving license test, you do a lot of driving on the simulator. And when you're confident is when you go on the road. Same thing, giving people the right environment to practice and apply whatever they learn. Having the feedback loop, again, very important. When people will go and practice something, they will give you feedback. You know, something is working, something is not working. And that will again, you can go back and say, okay, what can I do now so that people are able to get it right? For example, if it's a very complicated new software you're installing, everybody will not get it in the first moment. A lot of people will need a lot of handholding, and people may give you feedback saying, look, this software is very, very complicated to operate. I can't do it. And then that's the feedback. Then you have to say, okay, how can I make training more simple? How can I stagger the implementation so that people don't get overwhelmed? How can I bring in more experts who can train people? So variety of things you can do getting the feedback. In a lot of organization changes, you set up some, you know, subject matter experts or help desk, right? If you have any challenge, if you have any doubt, you just call them and they will come and help you. And that's something you can consider depending on the scale of change. simulations, role plays, a lot of them it helps. If it's a new setup, you're changing the office, you're changing org structure, sometimes role plays can help people understand, okay, what is really happening. And they can actually then try things out in a safe environment before they actually go and implement. So what at an organizational level and as a business leader level you need is to allocate time and resources, be patient, so that people try out things and they over time they develop the behavior and the skills required to successfully run the change. The last thing you can also focus is a lot in performance management, right? Now, what do I mean is that while you're collecting feedback from people, you also are giving feedback to people saying, look, you know, you need to focus more, or you need to spend some time daily on these training programs, or you need to take a time out from your diary and focus on these things. So it's also a process of continuously monitoring their performance of people. Some people will be left behind. Some people will be much ahead in the curve of learning. So you need to make sure you're managing the performance and monitoring them very well, so that you are trying to bring as many people along as possible. Ultimately, from this phase, what do you want from an ability phase? What do you want people to tell? People say, okay, I can do it. I know what to do. I know why it is required. I know how to do it. I have done it, so I can do it. That's the response you're looking from people. And the final phase of Edgar is reinforcement. Now, what do I mean by reinforcement is, look, any change by default may not necessarily be successful in the first go. As I said, there will be a lot of resistance from people. So how do we not just implement change, but also be successful in the long run? That's the key, because I'll tell you what you want. You want the change to be successful in the long run, right? You want it to be sustained. You want to get the long-term benefits. So you don't want it to be a short-term thing, right? So that's where the reinforcement comes into the picture. How do you build momentum, right? When you start changing, how do you make sure people build momentum so that change eventually happens, right? Sometimes their initial momentum, then it dies down. So how do you build the momentum? How do you sustain it in the long run? But it's not easy, because by definition, everybody will try to revert to the original state. You know, all of us, people and organizations are like rubber bands. What do you do with rubber bands? You stretch rubber band, it takes a different shape. The moment you release, it comes back to original shape. People are like that. Organizations are like that. So everybody will try to revert to the original state as at the earliest possible opportunity. So you need to make sure you continue that momentum so that you acquire the new shape. So remember that, you know, by default, everybody will go back to their original state or would want to go back. And that's where you need to make sure the reinforcement is handled very well to maintain the momentum and sustain in the long run. Now, how can you make sure that this happens, right? How do you sustain? One is obviously monitoring progress is important, because whatever you cannot measure, you cannot improve, right? So making sure you're monitoring progress through different stages of change. Celebrating progress, this is very, very important, right? Rewards and recognition. When small wins are happening, make sure you're rewarding people or recognizing people, right? Sometimes we get too attached to the end outcome, end goal, and we forget the progress people are making all through this journey. And you need to make sure you celebrate this so that people feel happy, people feel motivated, and they participate and sort of the momentum goes on, right? Corrective feedback. As I said, you know, if things are not going as per plan, if people are not doing what they're supposed to do, you need to make sure you pass on that feedback to people so that you course correct and bring them on the right track. Reverse feedback. Again, if you look at this reverse feedback is a common theme across a lot of the phases, right? You need to make sure you're hearing from the people. What is not working? You know, people have tried something, it's not working. What is that? What can you do now so that you take more proactive actions in the future, right? So this feedback loop has to be continuous during the change and after the change implemented. Accountability structure, look, it's very important to set that. A lot of times leaders feel sort of fall short of setting accountability to the team members. If the change is important for the business, for the organization, you need to make sure you hold people accountable. You give them roles and responsibilities. You show them that, look, this change is important to you because of these reasons and why they should participate in that change. And what are they accountable for? And if something does not go their way, they will be held accountable. So people should know that what are their roles and responsibilities, and it is important for them to participate, and they will be held accountable if things don't go well. So accountability structure has to be set up. And finally, acknowledging, right? A lot of time change is not, as I said, change is never easy for people. just acknowledging people, saying, yes, I hear you, I'm seeing the challenges, we are doing everything about it, you know, celebrating, you know, spending time with them, because it's not easy. So as a business leader, you need to make sure that you are spending time with them, acknowledging their participation and their contributions all throughout, can go a long way in building trust, and also people feel motivated. Yes, my management acknowledges my contributions, so I'm happy to participate in this change. Ultimately, what do you want from people in this last phase from reinforcement is, I have done it. You know, I knew why it is needed. I know how to do it. I did it. Now I've done. I learned the new software or whatever the change is, and I've done it. It's a done deal. So that's the thing you want people to reach to that stage through the last stage of Edgar. So I'll do a quick recap before we open for Q&A. See, we covered, I know it's, we covered quickly because it's actually a full day's training we do, but it's a short webinar. So we covered the Edgar model. We said, how do you create awareness? How do you influence desire? How can you enable change through knowledge and ability? And how can you ensure sustainability of the change? We covered those in the last 40 minutes or so. Ultimately, the idea of the Edgar model is that each stage you get these responses from people. People tell you, right, I get it. Why the change is needed? I will participate in the change. I know how to do it. I know I can do it. And I have done it. So that's the five outcomes you're looking through each of the stages of the Edgar model. Finally, I want to leave you with this thought is that, look, any form of change begins with you. You know, Leo Tolstoy said, it was a very famous quotation where he said that everybody wants to change the world, but nobody wants to change himself. And that's something you have to go back and remember, that irrespective of what the change is, whether it's a small change, large change, any form of change has to begin with you. As a business leader, as a professional, as an individual. So that's the key thing I want all of you to take back. Before I open up Q&A quickly, look, there are two types of business leaders today, especially when it comes to change management. Those who think that change management is a nice development opportunity. I don't have to focus on that. And there are second set of business leaders who are saying, no, change management is essential. It's very, very important and central to keeping businesses and companies relevant in the current times. Two types of people. One set of business leaders will think change management is a nice opportunity. I don't have to really focus. It's not needed. Others are saying, no, it's very much needed. It is important because that's how my business will grow. So you have to think that on which side of the line you lie as a business leader. Before I again close, I'm going to share quickly how you can connect with me in case you want to connect further. Look, as I said, I do personal coaching, I do group coaching, I do corporate training programs. So you can follow me on LinkedIn. That's my LinkedIn ID. If you want to connect, if you want to know more about what I do, you can drop me a mail in office@harshjauri.com. And if you need to get into personal call, that's the calendar link. I can share that later on. You can book a small 15-20 minute discussion consulting call with me as well. So that's really from my side. I'm going to stop now my presentation and I'm going to open up for questions, answers about today's training or anything in general you would like to ask. Okay, Mohammed, over to you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Johari, for this inspirational presentation. It was interesting to learn more about agility and how we could, and how it is important to cope up with fast organizational change. Further, the Edgar model for managing change seems very effective. I liked how it highlighted the feedback mechanism as a very important element in the communication strategy and their awareness. I'll leave the floor for the attendees to raise any questions that they may have. You may either post it under the chat section or under the Q&A. We'll give you a couple minutes for that.
I mean, I'm open to answer questions on change management or any other topic also where you feel my input is needed.
One question about Mr. Lade is saying, sometimes we feel the pain. We know that we need to make change, but management may be unwilling to make the change. So what advice may you give?
So it happens. I think it's a very practical question. Sometimes you would like to some change to happen, but your management is not prioritizing. And it's purely a question of what is important for the business, right? So I think that's the key thing, right? And from your side, what you can do is, how well are you articulating the pain and the cost of inaction? A lot of times we want things to happen, but the way we articulate the problem is not clear to people. The way we articulate the problem is not big enough. Because remember that if you think from an organization point of view, where will people spend money? People will spend money to solve problems which are expensive to solve and which are urgent to solve. There'll be a whole lot of things which needs to be solved. There'll be a lot of problems in an organization, any organization, but you cannot allocate budget to everything, right? So you have to go back and think that if I am going through a pain or my team is going through a painful process, how can I articulate this as, and how can I show the big picture to people, right? Sometimes you are the way we present our problems is very short-sighted, right? So how can I show the big picture? How can I show that, you know, why this is important to solve? And how can I bring evidence or data to prove it? Saying this is really, really important for the organization, right? Sometimes people will still not get aligned to it. And it's not that they don't want to do it. And they are not seeing the benefit. So it becomes onerous on us to show why it is required. This could mean that you have to go back and do a lot of research, talk to a lot of people, collect a lot of data, and see. Again, ultimately, it's a question of prioritization. If you want your issue to get prioritized, you need to make sure it becomes important, not simply because you are feeling that way. And it is in the larger context of the organization, it is important. So just be aware of that. Sometimes you may feel that for me, it is important. But when you zoom out and look at an organizational level, maybe it is not as big a problem. And to make it big or to make it really, really strong case, you have to really make your case really strong. So that's what I would suggest from your side, which means that you may have to do a lot of work in that. It may still not happen, but present your case with a strong argument. Really.
Okay, another question. Thank you, Mr. Johari. Another question here is basically saying, what challenges would a leader face or management face in a multicultural team?
As I said, multicultural team, the challenge primarily would be to understanding the desire part, because when you're working in multicultural teams, everyone's motivation levels or what motivates them could be very, very different. Right, in some cultures, change is a way to live, right? You always constantly evolving change. In some cultures, change does not happen so easily. So I think when you're working on multicultural teams, the key is to spend time to understand what motivates your people, right? Because whether people are coming from multicultural or not, ultimately at a human level, that understanding is required. And sometimes the cultural angle could change what motivates people. So If you're driving change multicultural organizations, see how you can spend more time with people, understand what motivates them, also understand what communication works best for them. Again, there is a cultural aspect to communication also. Some cultures, it's a direct way of communication. Some cultures want a different way to communicate. Some cultures, in some systems, you may have people who are very expressive. In some cases, people are very visual in nature. So different cultural angles come in a communication part. So I think desire and communication are two areas where you need to focus when it comes to dealing with multicultural people.
Thank you, Mr. Johari. Another question here. How would rewards and recognition beneficial impact be, or how would the rewards and recognition benefits be categorized in change management? Would they be temporary? Would they have a temporary impact or a permanent impact?
I think you need both, right? Because you need to motivate people, you need to sustain people. So there has to be some reward and recognition linked to the process of change, that if you do these things, if you implement these things, this is how you will be recognized. So there has to be a temporary angle to it. And then once the change is implemented, that becomes a part of the system. Then it goes into the long-term performance management. So there is a longer-term reward available to you if you make sure the change is successful in the long run. So I think there are both the angles. The temporary or the short-term reward and recognition needed because you want people to feel motivated, you want people to feel recognized, you want people to sort of really actively be champions of change or a change agents. So you need that sort of temporary or short-term reward for sure. And then obviously once the change has happened, you need to make sure that how will you measure performance, vis-a-vis this change in the long run. So I think what you need is a combination of both short-term rewards and long-term rewards. And at some point, that change will become part of the system. You know, then it may not be required. But I think initial phase, it will be a combination of both which is required.
Thank you very much. Another question from Abdul Fattah. Where is the KPI in the section of ability?
Sorry, what is the question? Sorry, I didn't get one.
Where is the KPI in the section of ability? Or do we have a KPI in the section?
Yes, KPI will be there. KPI, in fact, is both in the knowledge and ability, right? When I said new roles and responsibilities, right? So what are the new roles? What are the new responsibilities? What are the new KPIs you're going to set up? What are the new KPIs expected from you during that change? And what are the new KPIs or KRAs expected once the change happens? So I think it sits both. You can clarify and articulate KPIs during the knowledge section also, because that's about the how part, and also in the ability part. When people are doing, you say these are the KPIs against which you will be measured. And KPI will obviously form a part of the longer term change, because eventually in the long term, you will measure people's performance against those KPIs. So it sits across, I would say, knowledge, ability, and reinforcement, all the three.
I see also here a common question, perhaps, but it was rewarded in different ways. It's all addressing the resistance, how to overcome resistance. And I think we addressed this in the first question somehow, but maybe if you can shed some light on it.
Sure. So see, resistance is linked to desire. Why will I resist change when I don't understand why this change is happening? That's my default position. So for the best way to deal with resistance, understand and make people understand why is it important for them. And now different people will show different form of resistance. For example, let's say if an employee is very tenured and very, very, you know, 15, 20 years working in the organization, but now they are used to a certain culture, certain way of working. All of a sudden you ask them to change a new process coming in or a new software is coming in, they will not like it. It's very difficult. So what that you need to understand, what is behind that resistance? So don't try to overcome resistance. See, this word is not the correct phrase to use, that how do I overcome resistance? You cannot overcome resistance. What you need to do is you need to understand resistance. What is really underlying behind the resistance? For example, if it's a tenured employee, 15, 20 years in the organizations, and now they are showing resistance to change, it is not that they don't want to change. There is something more happening. There may be a fear. They may fear that, you know, can I learn this new software? What will happen if I don't learn? How much time will I take? Will I have to learn a lot of new skills? So when you're dealing with resistance, don't overcome resistance. Anybody who tells you to overcome resistance, that is a wrong way to approach resistance. You should never, never overcome resistance. You should understand resistance. And usually if you spend time to understand resistance, there will always be some underlying reasons behind that resistance. It could be people's fears. It could be people's doubts. It could be people's past experiences. And once you understand that resistance is, then you can do something about it. Because if you don't understand why that resistance is happening, like I gave an example of the child, a child not eating vegetables. That's a resistance. You cannot overcome that resistance, but you need to understand why is the child not liking vegetables. Maybe the child does not like the taste. And if you make the vegetables as per his or her taste, they will eat it. So you're not overcoming the fact that they don't like vegetables. You are now understanding what is the reason behind it. And you are now trying to tackle that reason. So that's the key to handling resistance, is understanding the real reason behind the resistance.
Thank you very much, Mr. Johari. Perhaps we could raise a question regarding what research or what studies need to be taken before applying a change. Like, is the research and analysis part in the awareness stage? Because you mentioned that awareness is to answer why, right? Mm. So does this entail performing market research or technical studies or?
Yeah, so I think there is, I think the question you're trying to ask is, what is the need of change? Why should we change, whether it's an organizational team, right? So this typically could come from a business problem you already have or dealing with. It could be coming from an external environment, like something like COVID. COVID has forced us to change. We didn't want to change. External environment has changed. The trigger could be a regulatory requirement, you know, certain rules and regulations, government policy is changing, hence you need to change. It could be coming from business results. Your business is not growing, your revenues are not growing, your profits are falling, hence I need to do something about it. It could trigger from technology. You know, technology is changing very fast and now I need to do something about it. And we have good examples, you know, companies like Kodak or some of the companies they didn't change, you know, were completely by Toshiba, you know, some of the big well-known technology companies, they did adopt to technology that fast and they were completely wiped out, right? So it could come from the pace of technology. So the change could be triggered from various angles, right? Sometimes you may want to find an opportunity for change. So there are three ways to look at it. I already have a business problem and I need to solve it. That's one way to look at change. Second way to look at it, I want to find a problem. What is the biggest problem I want to solve for my business or for my teams? The third is I'm going to hunt for opportunities that if I have to implement some change, what will that look like? So you could look at all the angles. And normally in organizations, there are enough business problems out there. But so you can be a solution provider when you think about change. You can be a problem finder or you can be an opportunity finder that I'm going to hunt for new opportunities. All of these three ways to trigger change or hunt opportunities for change.
Thank you very much, Mr. Johari, for this interesting and inspirational presentation. I would like also to thank everybody for their participation. I think we have a couple minutes or a few minutes left. If you have further questions, feel free to raise them to us at PMI KSA, and we'll be happy to help and support. I think we can take one more question, Mr. Johari. Sure. I think we have a couple minutes to take to go. When desire is more personal, as explained in the ADKAR model, how can be effectively implemented for organizational change to the whole team or company as a whole?
Yeah, this is a great question, right? I think what you need to do is first understand desire at a personal level. There will be some, and you'll find you can draw themes, right? For example, let's say people who have just joined the company, typically youngsters who have just joined the company, obviously desire will be very personal, but there could be common set of motivators, right? They are looking for growth. They are looking for higher salary. And they are looking for new exciting opportunities. So you can look at desire also at a thematic level. If you sort of club team members, or if you're able to bucket people in certain demographic profiles, that's one way to look at it. The second is you can spend time to understand desire of individual team members. And then the messaging could be common. You don't have to communicate to everybody that this is why changes will benefit you. You will always find some common themes are coming out, right? For example, somebody may look for career progression, right? And that's a desire to change. Now, if you're implementing a new software, will it help in career progression? No. But if you communicate the message saying, look, if you get trained on this new software, you're going to develop new skills. And this is a skill of the future. And this can help you in your future career growth. That's a common message you can give, right? As I said, it is not scalable to talk to every person, but I think if you do some demographic analysis, if you do some focus group discussions, if you do some sample discussions, you'll get a sense of what people are looking for, what motivates people, and then you can tailor your messaging accordingly. In small organization, it is possible. In one-to-one messaging, larger, obviously, there's a need for scale. So you need to also look at thematic level.
Thank you again, Mr. Johari. Thank you, everybody, for your participation. I think we are ready now to conclude our presentation. Inshallah, you will find this presentation or this webinar uploaded into our channel soon. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for joining, and thank you. I hope all of you have learned. See what you can go back and try whenever you're leading and driving change. And if you need any further clarity, please connect with me. But thank you so much for joining us today. And thank you for providing the opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.